Okay. Hi. How are you doing? Without a doubt, the single most stressful thing in my life is having a huge clock in front of me. Okay, can you hear me? Good. All right. I think like basically everybody in the world, when I was asked to do a lecture, same way as I'm asked to do any presentation, I do the first thing that comes to mind, which is I go on Google and I look for some kind of inspirational quote to start with, something to, hey, it works, something to teach me, to give me a good starting point. George Bernard Shaw said, youth is wasted on the young, but if you Google it, it tells you that it was George Orwell. I'm pretty sure the one at the bottom is Kurt Cobain. One thing up there is J.K. Rowling and Harry Potter. All these quotes about young people, and there's hundreds more by all sorts of philosophers who you've never heard of and who never made it into Philosophy 101. The problem was that none of them really said what I wanted to say today and what I really wanted us to kind of talk about in the 14 minutes and 1 second that we've got left. This is my first ever TED talk, TED style talk, I should say. And they send you all sorts of, I don't know if I'm supposed to say this, but they send you all sorts of videos and they basically tell you how to do these talks and they give you all sorts of clues and lists and commandments and rules. And if I get it right, then there's basically only one thing of all of that that they sent me, there's only one thing that matters. And the one thing that matters is that you remember my one simple message from today. Everything else is secondary. And my one simple message today for youth movements is just to go back home when you're done or stay here and just create a little bit more chaos. Just mess the world up a little bit. And I want to tell you what I mean by that and how I got to it. I am, I think, the ultimate product of a youth movement. I worked out before giving this talk, and it had never clicked before. My wife and I are third-generation youth movement couple. My grandparents met through a youth movement. My parents met through a youth movement. We met through our youth movement in the UK. Can I say it at the end, and then you won't, you know, I didn't get all the... My grandfather was in Nord Olved. My parents were in Nord Olved Valomed. Yeah. And I grew up in a little town in the UK called Leicester, where my choices were almost non-existent. I grew up in Maccabi. I don't think there's anybody from Maccabi here anymore. It's neither here nor there. Anyway, gave me the chance not only to learn about being a leader, but also to actually be a leader. I was doing youth work by the time I was 15, and I got to learn about, but also teach about, the things that I cared about and was passionate about and that I thought were important. Israel, Judaism, religion, Zionism, drugs, sex, mental health, trying to be a slightly better person. And it was through the youth movements that I got to do all of that and got to experience all of that. When I got back to the UK, I was very involved with the Union of Jewish Students, the equivalent in the UK of Hillel in the States and in Canada. And I got my first taste of political activism, campaigning, leafleting, lobbying, trying to get people to vote for me even though they don't know me, organizing protests. And throughout that whole time, I kind of constantly looked back to two sources of inspiration. I'm sure you've all done this at some point during your youth movement experience. The kind of the two things that, you know, you get asked, who's your inspiration? Who's the youth leader or the youth movement that inspires you? And for me, there was always two. And it was always very easy to answer. The first one were these guys. Mordechai Anilevich, the youth of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. These were the ultimate, for me, the ultimate inspiring Jewish youth. They stood up at a time not only when everything seemed hopeless, not only when everything was hopeless, and they stood up not only against the destruction of the Warsaw Ghetto, but they also stood up against their own leadership. The New York Times thing that you can see, that you can just about work out what's written there, is a fake. It's satire. It's not real. But it kind of reflects the mood of the time, which is, let's just keep our heads down. Let's just be a little bit quiet. Let's not antagonize. If we just kind of go with things, maybe it'll be okay. And that sense that the only group who was capable, who was able, who stood up and said no, were young people. And it was young people that stood up from across the political spectrum. I know Mordechai Anilevich is claimed by one of the youth movements, but it was a coalition of youth movements that came together and said, wait, there's something else. We can do something different. For me, that was always one of the most inspiring stories. The second one was a personal one. It was these guys. It's the people that built the state. My Jewish hero was always my grandfather. Right? It sounds kind of trite, but he left Poland before the Nazis took over Poland. Nobody else in his family made it out, and he left because he was in a youth movement. He founded kibbutzim in Poland to teach people what a kibbutz was before sending them over to Israel. He then went over, came over himself, all by the time he was 16, at which point he lied about his own age so that he could get into the Haganah. He spent his time building kibbutzim, fighting for this country, and making this country what it is today, and something that we should never, ever take for granted. Those two groups, they were my heroes. And I looked up to those two groups of Jews, and what kind of daunted me the whole time was, well, what the hell am I going to do? How are we ever going to achieve what these people have achieved? The only thing that I kept coming back to, the only thing that kept coming back up in my head again and again, was everything that I learned from them, which was, you know best. I don't know if I'm still allowed to call myself young. I feel like that kind of shit maybe passed a little while ago. I'm still on the right side of 30, but married with a kid, and I think that changes things. But I always felt that young people had a few things that drove them, that made them, gave them a chance to be more than everything else that was going on around them. And what are those things? There's a few things that you have that nobody else in the world has. The first is that you're already organized. It's not a given in today's world that you already have a structure. There's already something there that you can work within. And if it's within your youth movements or within the wider framework, it's already there. You're already some kind of unit. The second is you have a moral call that's already made for you. And you can interpret it how you want, and you can use it how you want. But the moral call is there. Justice, justice you shall pursue. It's a Jewish call. If I'm not for myself, then who am I for? If not now, when? They're all Jewish directives. They're all things that Judaism brings to us. You've got time. I say that in the least patronizing way possible, and I was going around and around in my head about how I say it in a way that doesn't sound patronizing. My sense of what time was changed 7 months ago when my son was born. Suddenly I didn't really understand what I did with my time beforehand. But you've got more time now than you ever will again. And it's your future. What you do will have more impact on you than it will on me by, well, about a decade. You're the ones that are going to live in the world. You're the ones that are going to be there afterwards. And the last one, and this is where I want to tell you a secret that I learned during my time at the Union of Jewish Students. The Jewish community, the established Jewish community, wants you to be more radical. What they tell you is, we're the ones that fund you, we're the ones that give you the money, there's a line that you have to toe, there's an establishment that we expect you to follow, but that's not what they mean. Reading between the lines, what they want from you is they want you to be more radical. They want you to pull them along. I want to give you a few examples from my time in the UK. And I have to say, and I say this with the most modesty possible, we didn't change the world. We did a few things that we could do. When I was at UJS, I was part of something called the campaigns team. I worked full-time for the organization. And we had two main goals. We set ourselves two things, two targets. The first one was this. It was standing up for the welfare of Jewish students. These pictures are from an event at the Oxford Union, one of the most prestigious speaking societies in the UK. The Oxford Union invited to speak the leader of the neo-Nazi party and one of the world's most famous Holocaust deniers. And we thought to ourselves as Jewish students, well, what should we be doing about this? And we did all the things that they expected us to do. We wrote letters. We lobbied. We got people to cancel their appearances at the Oxford Union and say, I won't speak there if these people are speaking. We even managed to get ourselves some national press coverage. We got some senior members of government to resign their membership of the Oxford Union. But none of that felt like what we should really be doing. What do you do when a fascist is turning up to a university campus? And the answer is, you go and you meet them head on. Of all my time at UJS, this was by far and away my proudest moment. Because there's a thing about students, about young people in general, right? Which is that you don't care. You're apathetic. You're all playing, you know, games on your phones and spending your time on Facebook, and you don't really care about making the world a better place. I don't think that's true. And that night proved to me that it's not true, as hundreds of Jewish students left their campuses, got on buses, and came down and organized a huge protest outside the Oxford Union. We didn't stop them speaking. We stopped them having an audience because people were ashamed to go in and listen to them. But more than that, we said, Jewish students can stand up and should stand up and be proud. The second thing that we set ourselves was a sense that when there's something wrong in the world, as Jews, and as relatively privileged Jews, as people that live in a pretty good community, in a place where things are okay for us, we have a responsibility to stand up when things really aren't okay. During my time at university and my time working for UJS, it was the genocide in Darfur, one of the worst acts of mass murder of our lifetime, if not the worst. And we just couldn't stand by and not do anything. So we organized a protest before anybody else was really talking about it, and we weren't the only ones. Youth movements, Jewish youth movements in the US were some of the people on the front line of this. And in the UK, UJS and the youth movements got together, and once we got together and organized a protest, the National Union of Students, with all its 7 million members, got behind our campaign and said, wait a minute, we should be doing something about this. And to their credit, the rest of the Jewish community also came on board and said, wait, the students are doing something, maybe we should be doing something. And it was Jewish students that led the way. And the reason I was so proud of this was because I was the head of the campaigns team, but it didn't come from me. It came from Jewish students on the ground who said, we have to do something about this. And when they did, everybody else followed. And I mean everybody else. We got statements from the prime minister. We got international pressure. And the protest started because some Jewish students and some Jewish youth movement participants said, this is wrong and we have to do something about it. The last thing I ever did at UJS was go to the Durban Review Conference in Geneva, a big United Nations conference, which most people probably haven't heard of, about racism. And we had a whole strategy planned out, the World Union of Jewish Students and the European Union of Jewish Students and the Jewish Diplomatic Corps and all these big, important Jewish organizations. And we organized big rallies and we had lots of big-name speakers. And that taught me one of the most important lessons that I ever learned, because there was one organization that said, we're not interested in all of that, we're doing our own thing, and that was the French Union of Jewish Students. And we had no idea what they were up to. We had no idea what they were planning. The reason we were so angry at this conference was because the person opening it was Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, who at the time was the president of Iran. When he got up on stage, three French Jewish students broke out of nowhere with clown wigs on and basically just shouted that the whole thing was a circus. The next day, this was the photo in the press. It was this guy saying, this whole thing's a joke. It was Jewish students who did exactly what wasn't expected of them. They got up and they did something slightly crazy, slightly radical, slightly pushing the boundaries. And in the end, that's what makes the difference. They say today that there's a crisis of leadership. We look at Israel. I have to be careful what I say because this is being filmed and I was introduced as speaking for the president. I'm not speaking for the president today. But the prime minister of Israel today suffers from exceptionally low approval ratings. Right? When people ask if they like him or not, the majority of Israelis say no. But when people are asked, is he your favored candidate for prime minister, the majority of Israelis say yes. What does that say about leadership? But leadership isn't just about being the person at the front. Leadership comes from the ground. It comes from the bottom up, and I think that's where you come in. I guess what I want to say is just this. Don't be afraid to be the ones that do something that's radical, that do something that no one expects. TED Talks were initially about selling technology. I'm terrible with computers and science. But this is what I can sell to you. This is what I have for you, and this is my challenge for you. I believe that Jewish youth movements are the best placed, and if they want to be the best motivated, to go out and turn the world upside down. And I don't say that as an exaggeration, but I say it as a challenge. My boss, Shimon Peres, says two things that I really like, which I always take with me. The first one is when he's asked what the greatest contribution of the Jewish people to the world is, he says the greatest contribution of the Jews is dissatisfaction. Right? We're never happy. Jews are never satisfied with the way the world is. We're always looking to change it. And the second thing is, he says, what's his message for young people? The message is when people say to you, you're the leaders of the future, all those quotes right at the start about the future's in your hands, it's nonsense. Now is in your hands. And you have the ability to change what's happening right now. I want to say one word about Israel before I run out of time. Increasingly, witnessing from the sidelines, Jewish education has become about teaching you guys how to go back home to your communities and talk about Israel. How do you advocate for Israel? How do you talk about Israel? Should you do it in the way that AIPAC do or the way that J Street do? Should you always be pro-Israel or should you be critical? And I actually think that's missing the point. As Zionist youth movements, as Jewish youth who care about Israel, I think your campaigning about Israel should be about changing Israel. It should be about making this country what you want it to be. And there's a whole spectrum of youth movements here. And the last thing I would ever say to you is what that campaign should be, because I honestly stand by and believe in peer leadership. You guys know best. But find what it is that you want changed about this country and change it. Don't pass that buck on to somebody else. Don't pass the responsibility on somebody who's got more money or who's older or who's got a meeting with the prime minister or the president. Do it yourselves. Decide what it is that should be different. If you think we should be going a different way, make it happen. Don't wait for somebody else. And the most important thing, don't be afraid to create a little chaos along the way. Everybody's looking to you and everybody wants you to do it. I hope that's a message you can take with you. I hope it's something that can be useful for you. You really are the greatest hope that we have to make this country and the Jewish world better and the world at large. Think large, think big, think creatively, and create some chaos. Thank you very much.